Hi everyone and welcome to this new Twinmotion tutorial. In this video, we'll be looking at all things lighting. In Twinmotion, there is many ways to set up the lighting around your project. And the first thing is using the natural light. Here we have a nice sun in front of our building. If you want to change time of day, you can do that in multiple ways. The first one is by clicking on the eye icon in the viewport in the top right corner. Click on the sun icon, and here you can change the time of day. As you can see, it affects the whole project. There is even a way in Twinmotion for artificial light to only turn on when the sun comes down. That's actually the case in some light on our project, like the one near the car, for example. We'll cover that a bit later. So you can change the time of day with this option. You can also change it by clicking on the ambience in the scene organizer, coming to the environment. And that's the first option in the global lighting. Here you can change again the time of day, and there are actually way more control over here. You can change the exposure of your camera, so here you can make the whole scene more or less bright. And in the details here, there are many different options to keep customizing your project. For example, here you can decide to disable the auto exposure. So here now you can manually control it on every keyframe or every image on your media. I like personally to have it on auto exposure on. That means it manually sets the exposure based on what your camera have inside the viewport. The next option is the sun intensity and sun size. So here you can control the intensity of the sun and also its size. There is also the sun reflection. So here, if we look at our terrain, our road, we can play with the reflection that the sun have on all those surfaces. We can also change the moon intensity. So if we come maybe on this way, change the time of day, so we have the moon that is coming out. Here we can change same thing, moon intensity, and also the stars intensity. So at 0%, no more stars. At 3 here, there are way more stars visible. Next option, control the ambient lighting and the white balance. The ambient light increases or decreases the general light inside your project. It's mostly visible in the shaded area of my project, so I'm going to move on the inside to show you that. So here it's at the default value of 0.75. If I'm moving that to 0, as you can see, where there is no direct light coming in from my sky here, it's very dark. So the ambient lighting will add some light, especially on those areas. By default, that light is a bit blue, but you can play with the white balance just to turn it into a more white or yellowish color. Talking about natural environment, natural lighting, we also have the weather. It doesn't have a critical role, but for example, when you play with the cloud coverage slider here, cloud will appear and it will slowly block the sun ray. So as you can see here, when it's fully raining, we don't see a direct impact of the light anymore on our project. We can also, for example, disable the weather effect. So here we just have a covered sky, without the rain or without the snow if we are in winter. But here you can especially see that the weather still have an impact on the general lighting of your project. The next option that impacts the lighting is the location. So here, if I open the details, I can manually geolocalize my project where it's supposed to be built. And based on that, I will retrieve the correct position of the sun to make some proper sun studies. The slider on top here, the sun north offset, define where the north of your project is. So in our case, the north of that project was in the back of it near those mountains here. So here we took that slider and we just turn it roughly 280 degrees just to place it accordingly. And then it defines where my sun rays and where my sun sets. Here you can also type a specific address if you have one. And here you can even change the months and see throughout the year how the lighting of your project will evolve. So that's it for the first lighting method, which is using the sunlight. Now let's jump into the HDRI environment. When you turn that on, you will be able to choose an HDRI texture to set up and to power up the lighting inside your project. So here, for this project, we choose that really almost stormy HDRI that works really great with our environment. You can have access to many of those HDRI just by coming to the HDRI environment. Here you have one with just the sky. The other have also some interior or exterior type of object in the HDRI itself. Let's jump into our sky. It's divided in three subcategories that define the time of day. So we have the low sun, the morning and an afternoon, and the noon. If we try, for example, a low sun, maybe with some clouds, that's what we have available in the library. Those textures, those HDRI textures are available on the cloud and available on demand. That means that when you want to add one to your project, you will need to click on the download button to download it locally on your machine. Right now, I'm not logged in into my Epic Games account, so I will click on that icon in the top right corner of the screen to log in. Once done, that icon is now available, so I can click on it and download the texture I want. Let's maybe scroll down and let's say I would like maybe that one here. Now that my HDRI has been downloaded, I can simply drag and drop it into my scene. Once my HDRI has been imported into my scene, I can come to my HDRI environment. And here I can change a few things. I can change its intensity. I can also play with the rotation of the texture. Let's jump back with our previous HDRI. When you choose an HDRI texture, it's the HDRI that controls where the sun is and that creates all the shadow that we can see on our project. So for example, here if I come back to the location, here the north offset option is disabled. Same thing in the global lighting, the time of day option is disabled. What you can do, however, is come to the details of your HDRI environment and click on Lock Sun to HDRI. That's the option that defines that the sun present in the HDRI will set up and will enlight the whole project. If you turn that off, you can manually set a different time of day than the one present in the HDRI. So here, for example, now I can come back to that slider, change the position of the sun, and I can also change the time of day. Be careful when doing that, because if you have a sun that is present inside your texture, that might feel weird to have the actual position of the sun in a totally different position. So here, in our case, there are a lot of clouds inside our project. If we don't really look in that direction, or if we just maybe turn the rotation of the texture a bit on that side, we won't really see that the position of the lighting is not 100% accurate, but just something to bear in mind. I generally prefer to leave that option on, but I just wanted to show you the effect of it. The next way you can add lighting to your project is with artificial light. So we'll come to my library, lights, and here there are many different types of lights. So you have the omnidirectional light that will create light in all directions. So let's actually come inside our project. I'm going to turn the position of the HDRI just so we have a bit more shadow inside our project, like we can see here. Now what I'm going to do is drop an omnidirectional light inside our project. As its name, the omnidirectional light creates light in all directions. Here you can change the attenuation. It defines the distance where that light is visible. You can also here play with its intensity. Once a light is selected in the scene graph, down below in the property panel, you have all the options regarding that specific light. If at some point you open too many options and you want to see all of them at once, you can click on that icon to expand that panel to the left of the scene graph to just see more of those options. What you can also do is hide the scene graph by clicking on that scene icon at the bottom of the interface. Let's have a look now at some of the other options that we have on that omnidirectional light. First, of course, you can change the color of it. You can also just play with a color temperature slider just to switch from orangey to bluish. When you don't need any more a specific set of options, you can simply click on its name to close that tab. The next option is the shadow. When you turn that on, it creates actually some shadow on the object around your light. For example here, if I move the light a bit closer to those geometry, we will see the effect a bit better. When you turn the haze option on, it creates a foggy mist in the area of effect of your light, which is here 5 meters. So it's usually not something you will use inside, but outside it can give a really moody effect to the surrounding of your project. If at some point you are like me here and you can't select anymore your light because they are not visible on screen, and maybe you have the scene organizer that is closed, what you can do is press G on your keyboard to show the visual helper of your project. So here it shows a lot of things. The blue icon over here is all the decals. All the other icons that we can see here are lights, and each type of light have a different icon. So here, that's the omnidirectional light we just created. So I can select that one. Here is the icon for the area light, and here is the icon for the spotlight, or the IES file. Let's select back our omnidirectional light and turn off the haze. The last option here in the MISC, you can find an EOS option allowing you to load your custom texture. You can play with the reflection, or you can turn on the dust to down option. The dust to down option was what I was using on that car, starting to light only when the sun comes down. So here, what I want to do first is actually remove our HDRI to see our nice sunset. So I'll come to the ambience, I'm going to disable the HDRI, and here I'm going to play with the time of day again to see the effect of the dust to down option. So coming back to global lighting, and here I will play with the time of day, and at some point when the sun is low enough, as we can see here, light starts to enlight your project. So let's press G so I can show my light and I can select them. That's because, again, I have that dust to dawn option turned on. If I turn this option off, and if I come back to my ambience and change the time of day, those lights will remain visible even during daytime. The dust to dawn option works for light, but also for the neon material. So let's come closer to our car. Here I'm just going to enter my rear light. I'm going to click on my material picker and click on that glowing part. So here I've selected my neon material, and at the bottom of the settings here in the emissive details, we have the same option dusk to dawn. That will define that glow material will start to emit some light only when the sun is down enough. So we saw how the omnidirectional light works. Now let's have a look at some of the other light that we have inside the library. The next one here is the spotlight. When you drag and drop the spotlight, it creates a cone of light that you can then turn in any direction. Let's maybe start to drag and drop this one against that wall and have a look at some of those options. The most important option for the spotlight will be the cone angle that you can find over here. There are also all the other options that we can find on all the light, like the attenuation, the intensity, Also, we have access to the color temperature. And in the misc here, you will be able to load your own AES profile. The AES profile is a file format that describes light distribution from a light source, using real-world measured data. So, in our case here, I have an AES file that I'm going to load in that channel here. So here, let's place that light on a flat surface. I'm going to drag and drop the same spotlight on the other side so we can really see the difference an AES texture can bring to your scene. The next type of light that we have is the neon light. When you drag and drop that one, it has a length that allow you to define the shape of it. It works only in a straight line. So since that project is all made of curvy shape, don't look really well on that purpose. But you can use it, for example, to light a countertop inside your kitchen. The next one is the area light. It defines a rectangle that is glowing. Here you have access to the length and the width, allowing you to enlight a really large area at once. For example, in a project like that, if there is not enough light coming in from the window, which is not typically the case here, but let's say maybe on the back of my project here, I want to have a bit more light coming in from the outside. I could use some area light to fake the bounce of the sunlight. So here I will just turn the light. I'm going to switch to the local axis just to be able to manipulate my light a bit more easier. I'm going to change the length of the light. As you can see here, the attenuation is pretty close, so I'm going to raise the attenuation as well. So here it's enlightening as I want the wall of my project. I can turn on the shadow if I want, not really the case because it will create really sharp shadow in that situation. What I just want to do here is lower the temperature and most importantly, lower the intensity. Something maybe like 50. It just helps to brighten up that area that is a bit dark otherwise. Finally, the last type of light that we have inside the TwinMotion library are the one at the bottom here. It's those AES lights. It's the same settings as the spotlight that we already saw. It's just that they came with an AES profile already loaded in by default. So here there is a lot of different ones, but again, you are completely free to drag and drop one and load your custom AES profile. And that's it for this video. Thank you everyone for watching it, and we will see you all for the next one. Bye everyone.